I have compiled 100 or so common thesis defense questions, which we will look at later on. All these questions, in fact, almost all thesis defense questions can be put into three main categories. Let's go through them together. So the first category of common thesis defense questions are those seeking information which is actually already in the thesis. Let's look at some examples. Can you summarize your key findings in just a few sentences? What are the key research and authors in this research area? What are the main ongoing debates or issues in this research area? What is the significance of your chosen topic? Why did you choose this topic? Why did you use the research methodology that you used? What sampling procedure did you use? Why did you arrive at this sample size? Why did you include these variables in your regression analysis? How do your findings compare to other studies in the field? So these are all examples of questions asking for information which is already in the thesis or the dissertation. If I wrote my thesis properly, and as long as I can remember what I wrote, then these questions should be relatively easy to answer. Can I summarize my key findings in a few sentences? Sure, because I've already summarized my key findings in the abstract or in the executive summary. The key researchers and authors in this area, well, they're already covered in the lit review chapter and probably in the discussion chapter. Ongoing debates already talked about in my lit review and in my discussion. Why did I choose this topic and the significance of this topic are already covered in the intro. Sample size and sampling procedures are already described and justified in my methodology chapter. How my findings compare to other studies are carefully discussed in the discussion chapter. So the answers to these questions are simply in the thesis. As long as my thesis is properly written, and as long as I can remember what is in my thesis, I can address these questions, no problem. Now, in my observation and in my experience, these questions asking for information that is actually in the thesis, are more common in bachelor and master level thesis defenses, and they are less common in PhD defenses. And this is probably because these questions are relatively easy to ask and answer. Another potential reason might be that these questions are asked to check whether or not the student performed the research and wrote the thesis themselves. And because ghostwriting is more of a potential concern for bachelor thesis and master thesis, these questions are asked a bit more in bachelor and master level defenses. Ghostwriting is less of a problem for PhD dissertations, so it appears to me that these questions are not very frequently asked in PhD defenses. The second main category of common thesis defense questions are what I call reflective hypotheticals. So these questions are certainly related to the content of the thesis, but they are not directly or specifically focused on the actual substance of what is actually in the thesis per se. Let's look at some examples of these reflective hypotheticals. If you were to perform this research study all over again, what would you do differently? If you could choose a different research methodological approach to investigate your research question, which research methodology would you use and why? Instead of this, had you done that, what do you think would be different in your findings? If you were an assessor of this research study, how would you grade this work? What would you consider to be the most problematic issue concerning this study? So these reflective hypothetical questions can be a little bit more difficult to prepare because you don't know which direction these hypotheticals would go. And because these questions are not about actual things that are in the thesis, I can't simply try to memorize everything that I wrote and then be able to address these questions. Which means this second category of thesis defense questions can be a little bit challenging to answer. But the thing about these questions is that if they are properly addressed and answered, they can actually lead to very interesting discussions in the defense. So if you answer these questions well, it can really make the defense much more interesting and enjoyable. And if you answer these questions properly, it can add colors to the defense and help impress your professors. And the final and third category of common thesis defense questions, what many would consider as a difficult type of questions, would be challenging and accusatorial questions. So these questions are asked by the professors to point out something that they believe was not correct. They may be pointing out things which they view as incorrectly done, or they might be pointing out what they perceive to be important omissions, something that should be in the thesis, something that should be addressed by the thesis, but wasn't. Let's take a look at some examples. The study done by author X demonstrated Y, which clearly illustrates that your study failed in Z. And yet, you made no mention of this in your lit review nor in your discussion. How do you justify this serious omission? Let me point out to you that the theory that you use to conceptualize your model, or this particular scale which you use to measure this variable, is now considered outdated, obsolete, or unreliable based on recent research findings of so and so. This seriously undermines the value of your research. Your response, please. So these two questions are actually both quite accusatorial, accusing you of having done something incorrectly. And now let's take a look at a couple of examples which are more of a challenging nature. I'd like you to talk about why you chose to perform this study in organization A instead of organization B, when the topic appears to have more significance for organization B. For another example, in your practical implications, you suggest that organizations should do X, because that would aid organizational performance and productivity. I'd like to challenge you to give more details as to how organizations can actually implement this. So these two questions are less of an accusation, but they are challenging the student to come up with more information and more explanation about something that they wrote in the thesis. And these challenging accusatorial questions, depending on how they're phrased, can be actually quite difficult to answer during the defense. Imagine the context and the setting of a thesis defense, especially if we're talking about a thesis defense at a reputable university where things are done very seriously and very formally. A learned professor throws at you a critical and accusatorial question and asks you to respond on the spot, without the opportunity to consult additional literature, without the opportunity to speak with colleagues and fellow researchers, without the opportunity to think about it for a couple of hours. All that makes these questions difficult to deal with. I remember for my own PhD defense, I did everything I could to prepare. I had a lot of help from my supervisors, advisors, colleagues, and friends. But still, during the defense, there were questions that I found to be very difficult. And those difficult questions were these challenging and accusatorial questions. When I was asked about something which is in the thesis, I could answer very well because I knew my thesis very well. When I was given a reflective hypothetical question, I could still improvise and wing it and talk about stuff. But when a professor whom I respected greatly, whose work I cited extensively in my own thesis, asked me something which was very challenging and accusatorial, pointing out something that they believe I did wrong, well, that was difficult to respond to well right there on the spot during the defense. But you should be happy to know, despite all that, I passed my defense with no problem. You should be happy to know that that is just part of the game. Because the fact of the matter is, no matter how well prepared we are, chances are there will always be questions that we find to be difficult or even impossible to answer well during the defense. So don't be afraid of that. Now, if you want to know how to deal with these difficult questions, please check out my other video, Top 10 Tips for Successful Defense. As usual, let me end the video with a few questions. Do you agree or disagree with my typology of common thesis defense questions? What strategies would you use to tackle each of the three categories of questions? What smart ideas do you have to deal with those tricky, challenging, accusatorial questions? How have you experienced thesis defenses yourself? Please leave your thoughts and comments down below. And if your comment is a good one, then people will like it and upvote it, then everybody will see it. So leave a comment. All right, thank you for watching this Ranywayz random video. Please like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time. So here are 100 common thesis defense questions compiled from various websites. Some of these questions do overlap. I will read them one by one, and if you wish, you can pause between the questions and pretend to answer each of them. 1. Can you summarize your key findings in just a few sentences? 2. Why did you undertake this research? 3. Who are the main researchers in this area? 4. What are the main ongoing debates or issues in your research area? 5. Why is your research in this area important? 6. Who will be interested in your research? 7. What do you recommend based on your findings? 8. What are the implications of what you found to society in general? 9. What are the most important papers related to your own research, and how is yours different? 10. What other developments have been made in your field recently? 11. Why did you select the research methodology that you used? 12. In hindsight, should you have used a different methodology? 13. Would you have discovered anything else if you had used a different approach? 14. What are the ethical implications of your work, and how should they be dealt with? 15. How do you know that what you have found is right? 16. What is the weakest part of your work? 17. What would you suggest as future research, and why? 18. If you could start over, what would you have done differently? 19. What advice would you give to yourself if you could go back to the start of your research? 20. Do you intend to publish any of your research, and if so, where? 21. In a single sentence, please summarize your paper. 22. What is the singular idea on which your paper is based? 23. Why is the issue that you have chosen worthy of your thesis? 24. Cite the two most important sources for your work. 25. How did you formulate your research questions? 26. Why did you choose this particular research methodology over others that were available? 27. What advice would you give to anyone undertaking a similar thesis? 28. What value will your research bring to others in your field? 29. Did you encounter any ethical issues during the course of your research, and if so, how did you get over them? 30. Do you intend to publish your work, and if so, where? 31. What is the importance of your study, and how will it contribute or add to the existing body of knowledge? 32. Please summarize the key findings of your research. 33. What type of background research have you done for this study? 34. What are the limitations that you faced while writing? 35. Why did you choose this particular method or sample for the study? 36. What will you include if you are told to add something extra to the study? 37. What are the recommendations of your study? 38. Who formed your sample and why you selected this particular age group? 39. What was your hypothesis and how did you frame it? 40. If given a chance, would you like to do something different with your study? 41. What are the limitations you faced while dealing with your samples? 42. How did you relate your study to existing theories? 43. What is the future scope of this study? 44. What do you plan to do with your work after you have completed your degree? 45. What are the research variables you used? 46. Do you have any questions to be asked? 47. Did you evaluate your work? 48. How would you improve your work? 49. In a few sentences, can you tell us what your study is all about? 50. What is your motivation for this study? 51. How will this study contribute to the body of knowledge? 52. What is the significance of your study? 53. Did your study bridge any significant gaps? 54. What limitations did you encounter? 55. What are your findings? 56. What sampling technique did you employ? 57. Why did you choose this method? 58. Based on your findings, what are your recommendations? 59. Based on your findings, what areas will you suggest for future research? 60. How can your research study be put into practice? 61. How would you summarize your study to a practitioner in a few sentences? 62. What would you change if you were to conduct the study again? 63. What is your measurement instrument? 64. What are your research variables? 65. What are your research questions? 66. What do you plan to do with your research project after graduation? 67. What source of data was employed for the study? 68. What theories or theoretical framework is your study based on? 69. How would you relate your findings to existing theories and studies? 70. What recommendations do you have for future research? 71. What are the most original parts of your thesis? 72. Which propositions or findings would you say are distinctively your own? 73. How do you think your work takes forward or develops the literature in this field? 74. What are the bottom line conclusions of your research? How innovative or valuable are they? What does your work tell us that we didn't know before? 75. Can you explain how you came to choose this topic for your study? 76. What was it that first interested you about it? 77. If you were to write your thesis again, would you choose this topic again? Why or why not? 78. How did the research focus change over time? 79. Why have you defined the final topic the way you did? 80. What were some of the difficulties you encountered and how did they influence the topic? 81. How did you determine the scope of your study? 82. What main problems or issues did you have in deciding what was in scope and out of scope? 83. What are the core methods used in this thesis? 84. Why did you choose this approach? 85. In an ideal world, are there different techniques or other forms of data or evidence that you would like to use? 86. Why did you think a convenient sample was good enough for this study? 87. How could you be sure that this sample represented the population at large? 88. How did you determine your sample size? 89. What are the main sources or kinds of evidence? 90. If you have the opportunity now to reformulate your research question, what adjustment would you make? 91. Are your data strong enough in terms of their quantity and quality to sustain the conclusions that you draw? 92. Do the data or information you consider appropriately measure or relate to the theoretical concepts or underlying social or physical phenomena that you are interested in? 93. How do your findings fit with or contradict the rest of the literature in this field? 94. How do you explain the differences of findings or estimation or interpretation between your work and that of other authors? 95. If you were to perform this study again, do you think you would find the same results? 96. What are the main implications or lessons of your research for the future development of work in this specific field? 97. Are there any wider implications for other parts of the discipline? 98. Do you have next step or follow-up research projects in mind? 99. Throughout the process of conducting your research, what was the biggest lesson you learned? 100. Why does your thesis merit a bachelor's or master's or PhD degree?